Good evening, everyone. This is Dr. Ruta Kulkarni, President Assami India. I welcome you all for this masterclass. The topic of today's masterclass is management of physeal injuries. And for this, we have very eminent faculty today, Dr. Sandeep Patwardhan from Pune. He's a very famous pediatric orthopedic surgeon from Pune. He's professor of orthopedics in Sancheti Institute. He's a surgeon par excellence and even a greater teacher. He has more than 50 publications on his name, research papers, original articles, book chapters, and so on. So we are really, really honored to have you today, Dr. Sandeep. I heartily welcome you.
Thank you.
I also welcome other faculty, Dr. Ritesh and Dr. Pritesh.
Thank you, ma'am. All the members
on the panel, and I welcome all of you who are watching this webinar. So I hand over the meeting to Dr. Ravi, Secretary Assami India. Over to you, Ravi.
Thank you, ma'am. So in continuation with what ma'am said, I am going to introduce our faculty that today we are having our master class on physeal arrest, its management principles. Today we are having our faculty as Dr. Ruta Kulkarni. She's our President Assami India. Then Dr. Sandeep Patwardhan, Secretary of Pediatric Orthopedic Society of India. Dr. Pratish Singh, he's our state representative from Assami India. And Dr. Ritesh Pandey, he's our state representative from Bihar and Jharkhand. Our first speaker is Dr. Ruta M. Kulkarni. She's the current president of Assami India, and she was also the former vice president of Assami India. She is also the advisor of Ilzerov Subcommittee, Indian Orthopedic Association. She is currently the Professor of Orthopedics and Head of the Department of Pediatric Orthopedics at Swasthi Yog Pratisthan, Miraj, Maharashtra. She has delivered lectures on Ilzerov and Pediatric Orthopedics at various national and international platforms, chaired numerous sessions at various national and international conferences of repute. She has a lot of publications in various national and international journals. To her credit, she has conducted many workshops on Ilzerov and deformity correction and has contributed a lot in Ilzerov teaching. Her field of interests are deformity correction and limb lengthening. Welcome, Ruta ma'am. Our next speaker is Dr. Sandeep Patwardhan. He is currently the Secretary of Pediatric Orthopedic Society of India. He did his MBBS and MS from Mumbai, Maharashtra. He is the Professor of Orthopedics and Pediatric Orthopedics Specialist at Sancheti Institute for Orthopedics and Rehabilitation since 1999. He is also the Honorary Visiting Pediatric Orthopedic Specialist at Bharatiya Vidyapeeth Hospital, Pune since 2003. He has more than 23 years of teaching experience. He did his clinical observerships in pediatric orthopedics from Singapore, Germany, and USA. He was also the Posna Corps International Scholar in 2013 and visited Boston Children's Hospital and Rady Children's Hospital, San Diego, USA. He's also the life member of various prestigious national and international orthopedic organizations, conducted numerous pediatric orthopedic camps, and did a lot of free surgeries. He has delivered numerous lectures at various national and international platforms. He has numerous publications to his credit in various national and international journals. It's our pleasure to have you, sir, on Assami India platform. Welcome, Sandeep, sir. Our next speaker is Dr. Pratish Singh. He is the associate professor at Maulana Azad Medical College and Hospital in Delhi. He is also the state representative of Assami India for Delhi. He has presented research work in various prestigious conferences. He has many publications in various national and international journals of repute. His areas of special interest are limb reconstruction, research in Ilzerov methodology, and pediatric orthopedics. Welcome, Dr. Pratish. Our next speaker is Dr. Ritesh Pandey. He is the associate professor at Department of Orthopedics, AIIMS, Patna. He is also the state representative Assami India for Bihar and Jharkhand. He has many articles in national and international journals to his credit. He has delivered numerous lectures at various prestigious platforms. He did his fellowship in pediatric orthopedics from Mumbai, Maharashtra, and Assami India Fellowship from Beijing, China. Welcome, Dr. Ritesh. Welcome to the Asami India platform. So now I hand over to Dr. Ruta. Ma'am, please invite our first faculty, Dr. Sandeep Patwardhan, for his lecture. Thank you.
So we will go ahead and I invite Dr. Sandeep Patwardhan to give his talk.
Sandeep. Okay. Thank you, Ruta. So at the outset, let me first thank the Asami India and its president, Dr. Ruta Kulkarni, and secretary, Dr. Ravi Chauhan, and all the distinguished members on the panel. This is my first talk for Asami per se. I'm sure this is a vibrant organization and we will see more programs and it will achieve greater heights under Dr. Ruta's presidentship. So today's talk is basically on facial injuries, growth arrest, and how as pediatric orthopedic surgeons, we are managing the facial bars and a few cases to show you how things work. So let me just start by the basics for everybody. So this is the anatomy of the physis. Now everybody should realize that a facial arrest or a growth arrest happens not only because of a physical or a mechanical trauma. It's also important to understand the vascular anatomy of the physis. And second thing you should realize is that there is a zone of growth, there is a zone of maturation, there is a zone of transformation and a zone of remodeling. So as you move away from the basal cells of growth towards the remodeling metaphyseal bone, the chances of getting a growth arrest actually diminish. So growth arrest can happen if you have injury to the vascular regions, the zone of the Ranvier which supplies blood, or in the epiphyseal vessels which are supplying the basal growing cells. In the zone of remodeling, the cells are pretty mature and usually growth arrest will not happen. So you must understand amongst all the facial injuries, which ones cause growth arrest. The type 2, if you see the type 1 and the type 2 are the safer ones. But in type 3, what happens is that it's an intra-articular break so that you have disrupted the blood supply. It goes intra-articular and the transverse fracture then passes through the zone of hypertrophy just before the cells are matured. So more than actual mechanical damage here, it's the loss of blood supply to the basal cells which causes problems, and also it is intra-articular, right? So the type 3 Salter-Harris. And the type 4 is even more devastating because you see the fracture goes right from the articular cartilage across all zones and it disrupts both sides, the vascularity from the epiphysis and vascularity from the metaphysis. In addition to that, if you have comminution, it adds to the hematoma there and can cause further damage. So beware of any type where you have comminution. Or if you have a peripheral injury. Now, Peterson type 6, where partially the physis is missing, will obviously cause a growth arrest. And a rim injury, like I said, the zone of Ranvier and peripheral blood supply. So eccentric injuries around the growth plate also will cause a growth arrest. So these are the types that one should watch out for when we get a fresh injury, because these have the potential to create a growth arrest. If you classify growth arrest, it could be of two types. One is a complete growth arrest. Second is a partial growth arrest. The partial growth arrest is the one which is more damaging because it causes deformity in all three axes. The complete growth arrest will usually cause linear shortening, which as elicitor of surgeons is very easy to tackle. Even we can do it as pediatric orthopedic surgeons. But when you have a partial arrest, which is central, peripheral, or combined, then you're in trouble because it can undergo sagittal plane, coronal plane, as well as torsional deformities. In the earlier days, it was X-rays, which were used, tomograms for mapping these facial arrest bars. And Peterson has described these eccentric bar, a central bar, and a linear bar. So these were the types of bars that were described. But you should understand which one of these causes what kind of problem. So as I already mentioned, the peripheral bars usually will cause eccentric growth arrest and angular deformation. The central bars usually cause tenting. If there is tenting, there is change in the articular alignment. So you get an articular deformation, and I will show you cases. And complete or patchy or mixed kind of bars, you will get a combination. You will have shortening in addition to all kinds of deformities. How do you identify early fascial arrest or growth cessation? When you see injury around the physis, always in 6 months, you should see this Harris growth arrest line. If you see a transverse line, if you can see this transverse line, the dense white line, if it is parallel to the growth plate, it tells you that at that moment of injury, there has been growth cessation, but it has resumed growth. And because it is parallel, it has not caused any bar formation. The minute there is a bar, there will be tenting, and all these Harris lines will converge towards the fascial bar. So Carlson and Wenger earlier with tomograms used to map these bars and then give you a quantification how much percent of the epiphysis is involved. But today we have a much better way of quantifying a bar, and that is with MRI. So with your MRI colleagues, you should sit down and map the bar, and they will give you exact dimensions and the distance from where is the bar, how far is it from the articular cartilage, how far is it deep, and that will help you to actually 3D plan. It's like a navigation. So you should plan in your mind or with tools how you are going to approach this kind of a bar. What are the treatment determinants? The younger the child, the more the deformity. So it is always better that if your child is older, the amount of deformation is going to be lesser and the time to maturity is less. So time to fuse is less. The second is which bone is involved. The fast growing epiphyses like the lower femur or the proximal humerus are the worst offenders for bad deformities. It's preferable to have bars around the elbow, which don't cause much damage. Whereas anything around the lower femur or around the upper humerus is going to cause more damage, followed by upper tibia. So this is what is important. The next is location of the bar. Like I said, a central bar is better because it causes less deformity, but it can cause articular tenting and can be resected easily. Amount of bar is also important. If your bar is less than 50%, ideally less than 30%, the results are far superior to patchy mixed bars, which are more than 50% of the total dimension. And the nature of growth arrest, traumatic bars or growth arrests are better managed than due to infection, radiation, or vascular injury. What are your surgical options? When you have a partial growth arrest or a bar causing deformation, you have the following options. You could either shut down the physis completely, convert that into a complete epiphyseal disease so that you have only linear shortening to manage. Second, you could do deformity correction by an osteotomy, but then the bar remains and it will cause further deformation. So you may have to plan for multiple osteotomies. Third, which we follow most often than not, is resection of the bar and growth restoration coupled with growth modulation. Then if there is shortening, you can do lengthening. And finally, you have to use a judicious combination of all of these above. So I'll just show you some cases to highlight what's happening. Now, this child had an ankle injury, which was treated conservatively. And he has a diffuse kind of a lateral tibial fascial bar and a fibular fascial bar. The child is quite young. And as you see on the MRI, this is a very diffuse, patchy kind of a bar. Now, this kind of a bar is not amenable to surgical resection or bar resection. So here it would make sense for me to resect the residual physis and stop growth of that distal tibial physis completely so that I get a deformity correction and I convert this into a pure linear shortening. So what I did was I did a very low osteotomy. I went transfacial and actually took out a wedge which included the healthy part of the cartilage, the epiphysis, and then I closed the gap with tension band wiring. So that I caused epiphysiodesis, I corrected the ankle mortise, and I stopped total growth in the lower tibia. And now whatever 4 millimeter per year shortening is going to happen, I can manage it very easily with simple lengthening. Now this is a runover injury where the child had a runover of a tire of a truck over his leg, and he had soft tissue quantum loss along with fascial injury and loss of cartilage. So here you can see the skin graft and you can see the medial physis has overgrown. Now again, here it is impossible to do bar resection, but the treatment here will involve deformity correction. One for the soft tissue contracture, second for the bony deformity, and third to stop the growth of the remaining physis. So again, what we did was we did a transfacial resection, a fibular osteotomy. And now what I did was I put an external fixator and I'm partial to JS fixator. So I used a JS fixator with reverse distractors. I put distractors in the front and laterally I did over distraction. And over a period of time, I could straighten out his ankle and that scar tissue, which was a skin graft, and bring his foot to a plantigrade neutral position. And he was nearing maturity, so I did not have to worry too much about shortening. Now this 17-year-old child who had a fascial arrest initially had a severely shortened radius. Now in this situation, you can see that the ulna has grossly overgrown and the radius is short. So again in the forearm, rather than doing complete radial lengthening, I opted to balance out his forearm for a better function by doing a combination procedure. So what I did was I shortened the ulna. I used a plate. I resected about 1.5 centimeters and stopped the ulna from growing also. And then I used a linear fixator on the radial side and I distracted. So I brought the length of the radius to such a level that the normal radioulnar variance was restored and the wrist was balanced out. And you can see nice regenerate over 12 weeks here. And then when it consolidated, we removed it and put him in a cast, and that's his deformity, which is corrected out. And that's his function. So he can do his daily activity living very well. And you can see that he can function pretty well. So the next important thing is fascial bar excision. Everybody is interested in how to actually resect the fascial bar, which ones to resect. So the first thing is planning. You must map the bar with a good MRI. And then we must plan how to excise the bar. And third, when we excise the bar, what do we do with it? What should we put in that area? So we need to interpose something so that the bar does not reform. Here is an example of a fracture shaft femur, which was treated with a Thomas' splint. And the child developed a progressive flexion deformity in the knee. Initially, the surgeon thought that this is because of the long duration of immobilization, but eventually, when he turned up at our place, we found that he had a posterior femoral peripheral fascial arrest, which was causing excessive anterior growth and procurvatum. And now this was quite a localized fascial bar. So we mapped it, got the physical dimensions and the distance from the medial and lateral epicondyle from the patella and located it accurately, find out where it is. Second, we have to make a metafacial window. Now, this is one method which has been described for central fascial bridge excisions. It's the Jackson's method, where you take a triangular bit of metafacial bone, pre-drill it, so that you have to fix it with a transverse screw and take out a wedge of bone. And from that hole, you can approach the central fascial bridge. Once you do your resection and interposition, you can put that metafacial piece back and put a transverse screw across. So something like that was planned. Peripheral bars are amenable to direct resection. So here you can just go and see the dimensions and take out the entire. So excise the periosteum with it, use a high speed burr, constant irrigation, repeated SIAM, and always resect more than what is required. Third is visualization. How do you visualize? So visualization can be done or aided with an arthroscope. So when you do your resection, you can put in a small 4 mm arthroscope and with a good light source, inspect circumferentially that you can see healthy white cartilage all around when the bar is excised. Under SIAM, you can use a dental mirror also sometimes because you cannot see into the corners. So you can use a dental mirror and see the reflection of that white rim of cartilage, which should be seen once the bony bar is excised. Right? So from the metafacial window, you can go in, resect that bar, use a small arthroscope. Now, this is the case which I showed you earlier. We went in, we made that window. You can see the white cartilage here. And with curettes and burrs, we made sure that we resected the bar. And that was the SIAM image. That was the post-resection. And then the fifth step is interposition. So commonly used interposition material, which is locally available, is gluteal fat. It has been found that gluteal fat inhibits bone formation. And that is the preferred choice for putting in as interposition material. People have used cranioplast. Some people have tried to put iliac crest apophyseal cartilage, or people have tried stem cells or vascularized transfer, but results are not yet satisfactory. Fat does just well. That was originally described by Langenskiold. So that is what we put, the fat. And finally, what you can do is put small markers, put K wires 1 millimeter parallel to each other on either side, metaphysis and epiphysis. And then you must see the separation. So these are like surrogate Harris lines, which are metallic. We must see separation of these two K wires, which justify or which say that your bar resection has worked. So this is the 9-year-old. This was post resection. And at maturity, at 7-year follow-up, his deformity has corrected out with a very good range of motion. And he remains symptom free because he's now skeletally mature. This is, as you saw in the X-ray, it was 2003. This is a long time ago. This is another child who was treated as a metaphyseal fracture. And this 2-year-old, she was just 2 years old. But eventually, after the plaster was removed over 1 year, the parents noticed that she is developing a varus deformity. So this is after 1 year. You can see tenting and medial growth arrest with fibular overgrowth. So this is the X-ray picture. That was the joint line which needed to be tackled. That was the MRI which showed us that there was a central bony bar which was causing tenting of articular surface on the medial side. So we went in, this was the deformity. So what we did was I did a supramalleolar osteotomy in the metaphysis. From that osteotomy, we cut the fibula and then I overcorrected the deformity. And from this side, I went in and resected that apical bar. So that was the opening wedge. We resected the apical bar. Then I put in fat there and I used a small mini fixator. Again, I just put Jess fixator, couple of K wires and a clamp. It was just a 2.5-3-year-old child. And this is how it looked at the end of resection. That was the resected bar. That was the fat put there. That was the deformity acutely corrected. And this is a 5-year follow-up of that child, which is showing pretty decent maintenance of the joint line. The bar has not reformed. There is good growth. So much metaphyseal bone has grown since then, as you can see. And the joint line remains good. Clinically, she was absolutely fine. And functionally also, she was just doing everything without any problems or complications. And recently she came, she is now in class 12. And this is a 12-year follow-up of this girl who came back. She's related to an orthopedic surgeon. So whenever I want, they send me pictures. So this is a long-term, really long-term follow-up of a fascial bar resection when we operated her at 2 years of age. And that did pretty well. So properly indicated cases, you'll have excellent results. Now, this is what I was talking about, a central proximal tibial fascial bar with tenting and fibular overgrowth that may cause subluxation of the knee. Now, this is difficult to tackle. You can use the Jackson's modification. So I resected the central bar and used a growth modulation to get, and you can see the slope, the tenting has reduced and the tibia looks more or less horizontal now as time went by. And then you can't leave these children out of follow-up because they'll end up with opposite deformities or further complications. So you must have a very, very strict follow-up protocol. lower radius sometimes can be a little bit of a bother. This was a comminuted lower end radius. Three week old injury. Some surgeon thought that he must correct this. Remember that late fascial injury lower radius should never be touched. They remodeled very well. But he wanted to fix this. So they did an open reduction, put K wires, and they got a better looking X-ray. But eventually the inevitable happened. Though it was good earlier, there was a bar formation, and then eventually the radius became shorter. The ulna started growing longer. So we did a bar mapping. Again, we were enthusiastic that we should resect these bars. And you can see the white bony bar across. So we went ahead, resected the bar and put the K wires. I did a distal ulnar epiphyseodesis with it. And then I waited, thinking that this is going to work magically. At a 6-month follow-up, nothing much has changed. And at maturity, it really did not work. So the bottom line here is that it doesn't work all the time, and lower radius is notorious for bar resection not working. In fact, you can see that screw epiphyseodesis also did not work. The ulna continued to grow. So finally, we had to lengthen him again with a monolateral fixator. I lengthened his radius with an osteotomy and eventually got him to heal after lengthening. He's now satisfactory. Now, you have to, as I said, the age is also important. When you are very young, you can attempt this bar resection. Now, this was a 15-year-old boy who suffered a growth arrest 2 years ago. So rather than resecting the bar, and wiser from my earlier experience that distal radius bars really don't behave nicely to your resection, I did an angulation correction with distraction acutely. I shortened the ulna. I caused an epiphyseodesis of the distal ulna. I took the graph from here. I tilted the radius for correct slope, and I lengthened it acutely and put that graft here to get some length. And so this became a one-stage solution, and he healed pretty well and functions pretty well even today. So you can then customize the solution with combination procedures as required. Now, this is another interesting case. Now, this boy had an 11-year-old boy had a progressive varus deformity. And then he gave a history that he was hit by a cricket ball on the inside of his knee. So this was a classical RANG type 6. Initially, there was no fracture, but the perichondrium and vascularity on the medial side got affected. And he developed a fascial bar, which was eccentric and tethering the medial side. So this was the MRI, which showed an injury to the perichondrial ring, which is type 6 Salter Harris or RANGS variant. So what was done was we resected the bar. Okay, rather than doing an osteotomy, we resected the bar from the medial side and tried to restore growth. And we slowed down the growth on the lateral side by growth modulation. So that those here we had used cement, bone cement was used as a filler. And we have put 2K wires, and to our surprise, over a period of time, slowly 6 months post-op, there was not much change, but 12 months post-op, the axis corrected out, and you can see the wires, the K wires have moved away. In fact, the cement has also moved down. So at 18 months, you can see that the whole thing has straightened out nicely. And once that is done, we removed the growth modulation device. So we could restore growth and control growth simultaneously and get this. This is an 8-year-old femur fracture where nailing was done. Again, this is iatrogenic. We should remember that we are very close to the physis there. You can't leave nails so long. And this was a peripheral bar formation because of injury to the epiphysis on the outer side while passing an elastic nail. This is the MRI, which showed us that this was quite localized bar, less than 30%. And we could go ahead and tackle this. I resected that bar, and then we put a medial epiphyseodesis to restore growth on one side and control growth on the other side. And in 6 months, slowly it started straightening out. And in 1 year, you can see that the leg straightened out pretty well. So you can do a combination of fascial bar resection with hemiepiphyseodesis, which is temporary. So to summarize some take-home messages, always be aware which of the fascial injuries are going to cause a fascial bar. You must monitor what effect the bar has for some time to decide what kind of procedure you're going to do. Always get an MRI and map it. look at the age of the patient. Which bone are you talking about? Where is the bar? How big is it? There is a learning curve to this. Then you must plan the appropriate correction, have appropriate equipment, and please keep a very long follow-up till maturity. I hope this short presentation helps you in tackling fascial bars. The more you see, the better you learn. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sandeep, for a magnificent lecture and for giving an overview of managing fascial arrest. Are there any questions? Dr. Ravi, are you back?
Yeah, ma'am. Actually, my connection today is highly unstable, actually. I don't know.
Okay. Dr. Sandeep, I have one question. In one of your cases of proximal tibia, you use bone cement instead of fat. Why is that? And which do you...
So my primary choice has always been fat. But the problem with fat is always when you release the tourniquet, when you do the surgery, it is under tourniquet. Everything looks nice and dry. But when you pack in fat, it's loose oil. Actually, when you handle fat graft, you will realize that it's just lobules of fat which you are shoving into that gap. And once the tourniquet is released, sometimes you can see actually that flow off. Okay. So after some time, what happened was I tried to take a Vicryl stitch through the fat graft to anchor it to the bone so that it doesn't move away. And then with some discussion with international faculty also, we realized that putting a small blob of cement works equally well. Initially, I was worried that it is a heat generating thing.
Yeah.
When you pack cement, it might generate heat and damage physis even more. But a lot of people who use it said that nothing of that sort happens. And it's more secure and it doesn't flow off like fat. Which is why I changed my... Nowadays, I use a little bit of cement. But traditionally, fat has been used. So that's the change.
Okay. So with cement, you don't find any problem with the...
No. Only thing is after growth, if the cement has migrated, you might have to take it out.
Sandeep, sir?
Yes.
Sir, what you do about those wires? You just cut it...
Flush.
Yeah.
They remain inside. Nothing to be done. Don't ever try to remove them also. They are just markers.
Okay.
They are just metallic markers. You can also monitor it with the fascial, the Harris lines. But this becomes more definitive. Sometimes it's nice to demonstrate to parents also. See how this is growing.
Okay.
Sir, few people have suggested chondrodiastasis actually to correct these fascial bars.
So what is your opinion? Chondrodiastasis as well as stem cell implantation has been experimental for quite some time now. What has happened with chondrodiastasis that rapid chondrodiastasis has sometimes caused actual fusion of the physis and growth arrest and more complications than good results. That's why it's not caught on. Anything that doesn't catch on usually is not succeeding. And people who have implanted, I think there is some study from Dr. Vrusha Madhuri's center in Vellore. They have done a lot of sheep tibia fascial arrest, vascularized stem cell or vascularized apofascial grafts. And they found that there was some regeneration, but the fascial cartilage behaved haphazardly. It did not behave congruently. So I have seen her presentations and I have read that and they have said that, so what is to say that it will not form a chondrosarcoma tomorrow? The cartilage is not in your control once you put it. Those cells behave autonomously.
Sir, what so about your...
That's experience? Why it's, I would say these are still experimental, not in clinical practice.
Sir, what about your experience about using apofascial graft from iliac crest?
I haven't used it. That's what I said. I haven't used it.
Okay.
These are easily... You see, it involves one more surgery on the iliac crest.
Yeah, definitely, sir.
Whereas cement and fat are locally available. It's not a problem.
Okay. So are there any other questions from the panel?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah,
I have a
question. Yeah, Dr. Pratish, please go.
Sir, how much cement you use, sir? You said a small amount of cement.
20,
so you 20. Put that cavity and
So what you do is that you get small packets, 3000 rupees, 20 grams of cement. And then after you mix it while it is in the setting phase, just push it in that and hold that with a small bone punch. I use a punch and hold it in position till it hardens. That's it.
So you pressurize that cement in that cavity.
Pressurize in that cavity, wherever it is. If it is eccentric, you need to hold on, otherwise it will fall off. If it is in the center, not much of a problem. It won't come out.
Got it. Thank you.
Sir, are there any other question? Harsha sir? Basu sir?
Dr. Sandeep, can you summarize your criteria of bar resection?
So I would recommend fascial bar resection for bars less than 30% of the width, preferably eccentric localized bars, not patchy or diffuse, with the child being young, 7-8 years, where at least 8 years of growth is remaining. If it is towards maturity, think more in terms of permanent epiphyseal disease and lengthening with an osteotomy. When you have a lot of growth remaining, consider bar resection. Make sure it is in the fast growing physis, which is going to cause a lot of deformity if you don't treat it. If it's in a slow growing, like if you have a fascial arrest at the lower end of the humerus, it doesn't really cause much of growth related problems. Or proximal femur. We never do such. We wait till maturity and then do a corrective osteotomy. Okay. Linear length issues and coronal issues happen with rapidly growing physis in younger children. Resect bars which are 30% or lesser, and preferably localized to periphery, or then centric, which can be resected to prevent articular damage. And
okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Are there any other questions? Okay. If there are no further questions, then we'll move on to the next presentation. And I'll be talking. So I'll share my screen. Okay, so I'll be talking mainly about correction of deformities secondary to growth arrest. Dr. Sandeep has made my job very easy. He has given an excellent overview of how to manage a physial bar. Okay, so as we all know, the physial growth disturbance can have different consequences: angular deformity, limb length discrepancy, joint distortion, or combination of all. It can be, growth arrest can be either complete or partial. And bony bar, Dr. Sandeep has elaborated in details. It can be peripheral, central, or a complete bar. Peripheral bar causes angular deformation. Central bar causes tenting and articular deformation. And complete or patchy mixed bar causes shortening. So older the child, better is the prognosis. In distal femur, proximal tibia, and proximal humerus, the bars cause very bad deformities. Central bars are better. Peripheral bars cause bad angular deformities. Then less than 30% bars have better prognosis. And traumatic bars are better than post-infective bars. So aim of treatment is correction of deformity, correction of limb length discrepancy, and restoration of growth whenever it is possible, as Dr. Sandeep has elaborated. So with open physis, what options do we have? We can have resection of bony bar and insertion of interpositional material, resection of bony bar and corrective osteotomy, or growth-guided surgery. And these first two options are possible whenever there is an open physis or when the bar is less than 30% actually. Then the third option is ablation of remaining growth plate and corrective osteotomy when the bar is bigger. When the physis is already closed, then we are left with no other option but to go for an osteotomy and a lengthening whenever there is shortening. Osteotomy can be either acute or gradual. So I'll show you a few cases. So in this case, I did ablation of remaining growth plate and corrective osteotomy. So this girl had post-traumatic bony bar on posterolateral side. She developed this procerovatum and valgus deformity over years. She's a 13-year-old girl. And as you can see on X-ray, the bar was pretty big. So I ablated the remaining part of the physis on anterolateral side and corrected her deformity with Ilizarone. She had 1 centimeter of shortening only. You can see the cora of this deformity was somewhere here. So I placed the hinges here and did an osteotomy above and corrected the deformity. Because the osteotomy was done at a different level, you can see some amount of translation, and that was the correction. That was her appearance and function. And this is the 3-year follow-up. So ablation of remaining growth plate, corrective osteotomy and lengthening. Whenever there is shortening, we have to go for lengthening. So this 9-year-old boy had multifocal chronic osteomyelitis, acute osteomyelitis when he was very young. And he had severe damage of the growth plate in proximal tibia on medial side. You can see the almost 60-70% of the physis is damaged. And he developed a varus deformity, 6 centimeters of shortening. He also has valgus deformity in the distal femur. So I applied Elizaro for correction of tibial deformity. And for femur, I did growth guided surgery. So both worked quite well. I corrected the deformity in tibia. And after correction of deformity, I did 6 centimeters of lengthening. And this was the X-ray after removal of fixator. And this is his 3-year follow-up. He still has absolutely no pain in the knee. He is doing quite well. Function is good, but he has developed a little bit of shortening, about 2 centimeters of shortening. So he is going to need one more lengthening again. So coming to corrective osteotomy and lengthening, this is one case where I did acute correction. This boy had osteomyelitis. You can see all the puckering of skin, very bad skin. And this deformity is actually not in the knee, but it's in the distal femur. He had pathological fracture and malunion of the distal femur. This is how he was walking. So you can see this is a very big sclerotic fragment here. The growth distal femoral growth plate was completely damaged. And the distal fragment was in severe procurvatum, valgus, and rotated. So I thought there is no point in doing an osteotomy here and do gradual correction. So, and he had 7 centimeters of shortening. So I did resect this sclerotic fragment and did acute correction. After acute correction, I applied Ilizaro and compressed the bony ends and then distracted to gain length. So I could lengthen only 3 centimeters in femur. The bone quality was really bad there. So you can see complete correction of his flexion deformity. And he gained 3 centimeters length, but he was still short by 4 centimeters. So I lengthened his tibia with a technique which I have developed and published, lengthening over slotted plate. So this is his femur, and this is his appearance. Limb length discrepancy is completely corrected, and this is his function. So some deformities you cannot correct acutely. They are very severe. You have to go for gradual correction with Ilizaro and do lengthening. So this girl had trauma. You can see this grafted skin and multiple surgeries were performed. She has shortening and she also has equinus of the foot and severe valgus and recurvatum of the proximal tibia. This is how she was walking. So look at this deformity of the proximal tibia. Her growth plate in the proximal tibia was severely damaged. You can appreciate the deformity in this 3D CT. So this is an oblique plate deformity. Look at the real deformity. This is the real deformity, almost 70 degrees of deformity in the proximal tibia. So I applied hinges and did an osteotomy and did a gradual correction of the deformity. See, the deformity is getting corrected. She also had equinus of the ankle. So I applied a foot frame to correct her equinus. and that's the final result. So the tibial slope is nicely corrected, both valgus and recurvatum, and that's her clinical photo. So thank you for your attention. If there are any questions, I can take them. I think if there are no other questions, we will go ahead with your presentation, Dr. Pritesh. You can go ahead with your presentation.
I thank Assam Media for giving me opportunity. I'm thankful to the president, ma'am, and the functionaries of Assam Media for being present here and giving opportunities to all of you. I'm again blessed to present my small series of few cases in front of such a distinguished faculties in pediatric orthopedics and Elizabeth cases. So I will present a few cases of physial arrest. So as we all know, that physial arrest, they happen in the growing bones. So physial arrest, they result in some form of deformity. They leave the residual limb length discrepancy, and they also result in some loss of function of that part of bone or limb. So these all three things, they need to be tackled in a composite way while treating any physial growth arrest. So the physial growth arrest, they are multiplanar deformities. They have a component of malalignment, malangulation, malrotation, and axial length discrepancy. And all these four components, they need to be tackled in a composite fashion. So in clinical scenarios, we may confront with many types of deformities, right from hip, knee, ankle, or even upper limb. And each one of these require reversal. So while operating on real cases, we need to think over the physial bar, whether it is excisable or it cannot be excised, or there must be some overgrowing physis in the vicinity of that arrest. And if all these cannot be done, then the mechanical axis or the axis of that limb, it might be changed. The deformity might be having certain origin. And if it is periarticular deformity, then it comes with a different set of problems. So a systemic approach is required to analyze the deformity and plan its treatment. So my first case is a 12-year-old male child who sustained an open fracture around the ankle and with type 4 physial injury. So there was, he had physial, when he presented, he has physial bar on the middle side of the ankle, and on the lateral half of distal physis, the distal tibial physis, it was viable with visible growth. While the distal fibular physis, it continued to grow and it was all but healthy. And foot was also not plantigrade, it was in the varus malalignment. So the site of deformity for this patient was in the joint, and different I planned for osteotomy as well as physial ablation on the medial, on the residual physis, and growth arrest of the fibular physis. So I planned for osteotomy at the distal tibia, corticotomy at distal tibia, and it resulted in a correction of that physis. So this was simulation of that deformity, and the correction was done using software guided realignment, and with that realignment the deformity got reversed to a very comfortable zone. And additionally, the limb length discrepancy of that limb, it was also corrected through the proximal fibular, proximal cortical osteotomy. Another case of genu recurvatum, case of 17-year-old male child who sustained septic arthritis, who had septic arthritis in the childhood. And as a result of the arthritis, patient had patellar hypertrophy, patellar tendon malfunction with peripheral physial arrest in the anterior tibia. And this peripheral physial arrest, it resulted in recurvatum and hidden fixed flexion deformity of the knee. And the deformity was of severe grade, 39 degree of recurvatum. So I treated him with Lizarrow ring fixator and proximal corticotomy. And the realignment was done by software guided realignment, and the deformity was comfortably correct, reversed to a zone. Another case of distal femur physial arrest with xenoverum. So patient childhood injury, and when the patient presented, his age was 20 years. He had some injury in the childhood, and as a result of which there was growth arrest of distal femur, and the residual limb length discrepancy at when he presented, it was nearly 12 centimeter along with some xenoverum. So it was totally a femoral component origin with some pelvic obligatory. So I treated him with Elisarov ring fixator and lengthening, bifocal lengthening. There was some complication also. So bifocal lengthening was done, proximal femoral corticotomy and distal femoral corticotomy. But such long lengthening could not be done at the same stage, and patient faced some problems in terms of soft tissue contacts, and the resonate also, it appeared late. There was issues with the resonate in the distal femur physis. So full length could not be attained, but still the patient developed a comfortable length was gained, and the varus deformity was reversed to the physiological range. Sometimes during these physial arrest cases, the complications do happen. For example, in this case, patient has an open fracture in the childhood, and he has complex deformity which could not be analyzed in a conventional ways in terms of even with CT scan. So, and he had a very poor, badly scarred tissues. So although the deformity was reversed, but the soft tissue problems, they troubled me and the patient also. And the medial soft tissues, they break down. And he was treated by serial vacuum assisted closures and skin grafting and the dressings, and ultimately that healed. So this was my small series, and I thank Asami India for giving the opportunity.
Are there any questions?
Ruta, if there is a couple of minutes, can I share that case?
Yes, why not?
Can you, Pritesh, can you just unshare? I'll just...
Yes, sir. I'm...
Just to show that there is an alternate way of doing things. Can you see that? Is my screen visible?
Yes.
So again, yes. Similar kind of thing what you guys were showing. Right. So this is what I do. Okay. It's a very high osteotomy. And then I use allograft and bone substitute here to pack that area. And that kind of slope, right? So this is the AP, this is the lateral. Because of an... This is the on-table correction. So I have to translate the shaft posteriorly. You must get that slope right, because that is the one that will lead to degeneration later on.
Yes.
So just getting the deformity right is not the only aim. The joint line has to be horizontal.
Usually so these deformities have some fixed flexion deformity also, which is concealed.
So that's what I'm showing you. So this is what we got.
Very good correction. Yes. Sandeep, my question is, if the deformity is very severe, like 60, 70 degrees, then you have to open a huge wedge and put in a...
Yeah, I did.
So, don't you have any problem with the patellar tendon then?
I am just lucky, I guess. So far, I haven't had. So, like I said, I take off the tuberosity, I get my correction, and then I put back the tuberosity in correct tension to wherever it is.
Okay.
So that can restores the quadriceps mechanism.
Yes, Dr. Shah.
Yeah, I'm Dr. Shah here. That was very nice, Pritesh. I have a simple doubt. You told that there is a recurvatum deformity and FFD.
Yes, sir. I said.
But I could not see any FFD in the knee joint.
Sir, these FFDs are concealed actually. And depend on fine calculations on depending on the as Paley's method, we got those, sir.
Okay.
Yes, one can have recurvatum and FFD.
That's why I wanted everybody to know you can have it.
Yeah, you can
I
have
wanted
it.
You to explain.
It is considered.
And whenever you correct that recurvatum, actually it unmasks. So yes. Because of soft tissue contracture. So I have a doubt, Dr. Ritesh. In both your cases of distal tibia and distal femur, you overcorrected the deformity. Actually, you created opposite deformity. In femur also, you finally got it into valgus. In tibia also, why is that? I mean, you had ablated the growth plate anyway. So why did you overcorrect it?
Not overcorrected, ma'am. I corrected till the physiological range. And for ankle deformities, I chose once the foot is plantigrade.
Okay. But
I stopped when the foot is plantigrade.
The foot, the subtalar joint was in virus. Okay, Dr. Sandeep is leaving. We have to thank him for joining in, Dr. Sandeep.
Thank you. Thank you, guys. Sorry, I have to go. There's some function at home. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. And we look forward to many more such webinars with you.
I'm here whenever you call me.
Okay, thanks. Thanks a lot.
Yeah. Non-Elizaro techniques, but. Lot of deformities, but I'm not a big Elizaro guy. Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Dr. Pritesh, I have one question. Yes. After doing the osteotomy, when do you start distracting it? Do you start it from day one or you have some, you wait for a few days and then, like yes. We do for the lengthening things?
Yes, I wait for a few days. Latent period, I give latent period of say 7 days or 10 days, depending on soft tissues and my intraoperative dissection. Then I wait. Yeah.
The latency has to be there.
Yes.
If you want to distract, it has to be there. Okay. So my doubt about overcorrection, I think you overcorrected to make it plantigrade because the foot was in varus. I mean, the subtalar was in varus. So you had to overcorrect it to valgus probably to make it plantigrade.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Fine. Any other doubts? Otherwise, we'll go to the next presentation. Good evening, Dr. Jhunjhunwala, sir. Good evening, sir.
Jhunjhunwala has come.
Yeah. Okay, we'll go to the next presentation, Dr. Ritesh.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yes, thank you, ma'am.
Yeah.
Yeah, so this is a case of deformity secondary to post-traumatic growth arrest in distal femur. And this is the clinical picture when she presented to us. She was a 15-year-old girl who sustained road traffic accident 5 years back. And as per the history given by parents, she had a fracture shaft femur, which was managed by a plate. And the implant was removed down the line after achieving union. Later on, the parents started noticing a deformity around the knee, which was progressive initially, but it has become constant since last 2 years. So to us, she presented with a genu valgum of 38 degrees and a fixed flexion deformity of 31 degrees. She also had shortening of 3 centimeters and a stiff knee. There was hardly any movement, just 5 to 10 degrees of movement was there. And the right foot had equino-cavo-varus deformity. These are a few more images. And as we can see, the scar is self-explanatory. And it is giving us the idea about the initial injury. And this child also lost her right upper limb in the same accident. So this is how she used to walk. And these are the preoperative images showing the deformity. And we can see the child has attained maturity. We can't see the growth plate here. So we got the scanogram done, and we can see the mechanical axis is lying far away in the zone 3. Further measurements revealed the deformity primarily in the distal femur. The tibial measurements appear to be normal. So it was basically an oblique plane deformity, and we calculated the actual plane like this through the graphical method. And the plane of deformity here was 40 degrees anterior to the coronal plane, and the magnitude was 48 degrees. So accordingly, the frame was applied, and we kept the hinges slightly on the convex side so that we can achieve lengthening simultaneously. The osteotomy was done in supracondylar region. And down the line, the frame was extended across the ankle to correct the foot deformity as well. So these are the post-op images at 1 month and 3 months showing the correction in progress. This is at 6 months. The deformity is adequately corrected. The length is restored. Foot deformity is corrected, and the frame across the ankle was removed, and she was given an ankle foot orthosis. But the concern here is the quality of regenerate. And by this time, the child was very cranky. She was not willing to continue the frame any further. So I would like to have the opinion of the senior faculties. What can be advised here? Means she is not willing to continue the fixator anymore. And about the quality of regenerate means.
Is this your final X-ray? Is this the latest X-ray?
No, ma'am, no.
Okay.
So I will continue.
Okay. So we can discuss.
Can I?
Yeah.
Yeah, Dr. Shah here. Beautiful case, Pritish. What happens is many times a patient refuses these things. So you'll have to go for conventional treatment. Anyway, the deformity is corrected and lengthening has been attempted. The regenerate is not so good. So you can remove the fixator. What I had done is and put a plate and bone grafted that area. It went on to heal well. So I don't know. Infection is the greatest thing you have to think of, particularly with the pins and all that. So I start with antibiotics 3 days before and then only do all. Don't know what you have done.
Yes, sir. So we somehow managed to convince her for one more month, but the parents again returned back and they were requesting for removing the frame. But we wanted to give it some more time before we go ahead with bone grafting, and we wanted the pin tracts to heal. So we gave her a cylindrical cast. We gave upper limb prosthesis, and we started to make the child walk with weight bearing as tolerated. And so this is how she was walking in the plaster. This video is not working, I think.
Ritesh?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, where was your cora?
Sir, it was the cora was actually near the joint line, sir. Means in the distal femur only. It was not obvious.
How much was the knee movement?
The knee movement, it was totally stiff, sir. Only hardly 10 degrees.
Then why did you do the osteotomy at the supracondylar level? Why can't you do the osteotomy very near the cora? Because practically there is no knee.
Yes, sir.
It's a single bone. Okay. So you have done an osteotomy at a thin bone.
Yes.
Because this is the best case where you can get a maximum area of regenerate by doing an osteotomy at the just above the adductor tubercle level.
Okay, sir.
Because you can put a complete all wireframe below. So you'll get a wider area. we can actually do a dorm osteotomy like thing and or whatever maybe for lengthening is also. So you have done a, your frame was, your hinge was not correct. You kept the hinge at a higher level, not at the knee joint level.
Right, sir. Yeah, it was at the level of osteotomy in this case.
Yeah, that was not correct. That was osteotomy rule 3.
Yes. Hinge should always be at the cora. I agree with Dr. Vasudevan, sir. The osteotomy is in the metaphyseal-diaphyseal junction area. It should have been the metaphyseal osteotomy. Could have given a better region. Right? True.
Actually, the fragment was very small and therefore the osteotomy went a little higher. Yeah,
Dr. Ritesh, what
anyway,
Vasu
the knee was
saying.
Stiff and you had one tibial ring also. So,
yeah.
No, what Vasu sir is saying that when you are using a frame with only wires, then your osteotomy can be lower down. No?
I used a pin also, means the Shan's pin, but at the same level. Yeah.
But if it had been lower, then you can use the wires only and it can be lower down.
Yes, sir, I agree. It should have been.
The point is, there's no knee movement.
That is not the point. The point was, Vasudevan is telling that when knee is stiff, it becomes tibia and femur, it can be considered as one bone.
One unit.
You can do the osteotomy at the cora.
Even with Shan's pin, Ravi, even with Shan's pin, you can do a very low osteotomy.
You can do a
definitely
lower one, but it's okay.
It's acting as a single unit, na? In the stiff case.
Yeah.
I have one more doubt, Ritesh. Your decision to remove and put a POP, you're going to lose the lengthening and deformity may occur again. I get very scared about that. Because I have presented a similar case. When you open the regenerate part, you may not see on the x-ray, but you do see some white tissue which is there, and you put bone graft strips in between, it grows very fast.
Yes, sir. Actually, I was
reading is the only problem.
I was afraid about the non-union thing here more than the length, so I betted on that. And
but your pastor will correct the translation. Your plaster will correct the translation. It will align it perfect and allow the child to use the brace for longer time.
I think let's see what he did.
Yeah,
further.
What result you got?
Please go ahead and show the case completely. Then we can.
Please.
Can I speak?
Sir, please.
Principally, the hinges have to be at the cora. If you would have put the hinges at the cora, then the growth would have been much better and correction would have been much better. Possibly he would have got a better correction also and better growth also, better regenerate also.
Yeah, so this is the final result and this is at 1 year of surgery. And we can see I was... lucky in this case, it united well.
So, what you did, you have just continued with the plaster?
Yeah, I just continued with the plaster, just gave some more time. And I think it collapsed a little bit. But there was a good regenerate and good remodeling here. The knee remained stiff and she was walking like this here.
So, she was in cast for 1 year.
For 3 months.
Only three months. Okay.
Yes. At 7 months, we removed the frame and this is the picture at 1 year.
Okay.
So now, is there any movement at the knee or just a jog of movement like that?
No, movement is not there, sir. There is hardly any movement. Earlier also, it was not there.
Okay.
Okay. Well, not bad. You got lucky.
How she agreed to have a plaster for 3 months?
But your side shows there's 30 to 40 degree movements.
Yeah, sir. At knee,
from 30, from 30 to 40, that is 10 degrees only.
Oh, 30 to 40. Okay.
Yeah, there was 30 degree flexion deformity and it was fixed in that.
Right, way. Right.
Can you explain?
Excuse me. She was not ready to accept the Elizaro frame.
Yes, sir.
How she could tolerate plaster for 3 months?
So it was a little comfortable.
She must have got the straight leg, no? That's why, sir.
Yeah.
She must be happy with the straight leg, though. I think that's why she had continued.
Yeah.
Can you explain why she didn't get a non-union?
Yeah, please, sir. Archa, sir.
Yeah.
not me, Ritesh.
Okay, Ritesh. Dr. Ritesh, sir, please go.
Yes, sir. I think putting some weight there actually helped it. I lost the length, around 1 centimeter of length. I lost it, collapsed actually, but it helped in achieving union there.
Yeah, I think from my point of view, number one, she's a young child. But more important, you have done Elisarov surgery and already done corticotomy, and then you have done deformity correction with lengthening. So that has put or produced a lot of regenerate and a lot of blood supply. So when you have put this in plaster, afterwards removing for other reasons, the regenerate has consolidated very fast by making her walk, as well as because it's a regenerate, it's consolidated. If it was just a fracture and if you had put maybe union may not have occurred so easily, like what it has occurred in this case. So a fresh fracture and this, there is a difference, supracondylar area. Because in this, you are seeing a lot of gap on X-ray. In spite of that, it has united very well.
So, Dr. Rajesh?
Yes, sir. Actually, I agree with Dr. Shah. Though there is a gap there, it's cartilage. It's not a gap, actually.
Yeah.
No, no, that's what. It's not a gap. That's why I told you, when you open it, exactly. I had opened such a... regenerates, we can see white tissue there.
Absolutely.
That's the cartilaginous tissue of the regenerate,
yes,
in the initial stages. And that you split
of,
open.
Because of,
and
because
in,
of full weight bearing, the cartilage was converted into bone.
They get converted, because, yes.
Dr. Ritesh?
Yes, sir.
After you have applied the cast, after how much time you have asked her to put the full weight?
So actually, when we removed the frame, I checked for whether there is any movement at the osteotomy site or not. So it was looking as if there is some fibrous union type of thing. It was not frankly mobile. So as soon as she got a bit comfortable, I started her to make bear weight. Means I didn't give any resting phase there. Means on okay. third or fourth day, whenever the pain was better, means she was comfortable, she started to walk.
Full weight bearing on the cast.
As tolerated.
Okay.
Good, nice case for discussion
nice,
also.
Nice case, nice deformity correction.
You can unshare the screen.
You can unshare, Dr. Desh.
Yes, ma'am.
Lucky guy.
Thank you, sir.
Can you unshare, Dr. Desh?
Yes, sir, I'm doing it.
Thank you. So, are there any other questions from the panel? Basu, sir?
Done,
sir.
Anybody has done plating for this?
You can't do a plating because the skin is so bad.
Pardon?
The skin is horribly bad.
Yes, it is difficult. That's the reason I was asking you. But here you don't have a knee movement. So, you need not do plating only on the side where the skin is bad. You can choose other areas where you can probably bend a plate and try to fix it and stabilize it.
You mean medial plating, sir?
I would prefer those. Yeah. You have to, depending on individual cases, you have to select and do it.
Yeah, definitely. But
this is what I would have done, plating and bone grafting. Anyway, Ritesh has shown that you can put a POP also after you have got a good regenerate, which may not be visible for a long time. Isn't it? That too in a child.
So before wrapping up, Harsha sir, Vasu sir and Jhunjhunwala sir, what's your advice in both the cases, in immature skeleton facial arrest deformity and mature skeleton facial arrest deformity? How you proceed with those cases? In immature skeleton having the facial deformity around the knee because of the facial arrest?
No, those things, most of them are treated by our pediatric department. That's the reason they don't come into our hands now. Long back, I used to treat all that as per regular principles.
Then I will ask this question adults, to ma'am.
Yes. She's the right person to answer.
Ravi, adults, you were missing during my lecture probably. So I
missed the lecture because there were emergency calls.
I
missed part of the lecture. It was nice. Yeah.
So to answer your question, Ravi, so physial bar, if it is less than 30% of the growth plate in a young child and with growth remaining, good growth remaining, preferably post-traumatic bars, then I go for resection of bars. After resecting bar, I put gluteal fat, as Dr. Sandeep has told. I never go for bone cement because I think the bone cement burns the growth plate.
It's so, controversial basically. Yeah.
So I prefer to put in the gluteal fat. And then if the growth plate is, the remaining growth plate is still vibrant, then I go for growth restoration and correction by either applying a growth guided 8 plate or a corrective osteotomy. If the deformity is more than 20 degrees, I go for corrective osteotomy. So this is the thing I do when the growth plate is open. If the bony bar is more than 30% of the growth plate, say 50-60%, then there is no point in keeping the remaining growth plate. I ablate the remaining growth plate and go for corrective osteotomy. So that's the policy with growth plate open. If growth plate is closed, then I go for corrective osteotomy and lengthening. Directly.
Standard techniques for adults.
Yes.
But
I go for removal of physeal bar in a young child. If it is peripheral, it is easy to remove. If it is central, as Sandeep has showed, I usually do osteotomy, either supracondylar or supramallular, whatever. Through the osteotomy, I remove the bar and interpose the fat.
Okay.
So, ma'am, here you do lengthening or over-lengthening in a periodic cases?
Over-lengthening.
Means how you decide for the lengthening time actually. That's your question, Dr. Samsul. Yeah. After correction of the deformity or simultaneously doing the correction as well as the lengthening?
I do lengthening at the same time. Especially suppose the bar is in the distal tibia. I never use the osteotomy which I did to remove the bar for lengthening. I do a different osteotomy in the proximal tibia for lengthening.
No, ma'am. After you do the lengthening, when the growth arrest is there, you do... correction of the shortening or you do over-lengthening?
I do over-lengthening. With the Palais calculations, I can predict growth at the maturity and I do over-lengthening. Over-lengthening by 1 or 2 centimeters I regularly do.
Right.
With due counseling of parents because they are really worried. They have to, the child has to wear a foot raise on the normal side.
This idea. Ma'am, how you map those facial arrest?
That is very important, actually, ma'am.
MRI,
na direct.
MRI.
But almost for all or immature skeleton cases.
Yes, for every bar I do MRI mapping.
Okay. Dr. Pratish, any question? So, I think we can wrap up now, ma'am.
Yeah.
Harsha sir,
yeah,
your last comment.
My last comment. Sorry, I joined in late. I had 3 emergencies today. Couldn't join earlier also because of such reasons.
I'm very happy with
Dr. Ruta and you. Your team is so dynamic that I think almost every week it is happening. Every time it is happening.
Thank you, and sir. We need your presence.
That's why I'm asking you, what's your wise comment after a long time?
Look, whenever I have no reason, if I have a really solid reason, then only I do not join for our meetings. Otherwise, I'm there for you. I'll be with you all. You please carry on with your wonderful work. Beautiful. I'm very happy. And you should have a lot of faculty like what you're selecting.
Dr. Junjunwala, sir, also I...
No, Dr. Junjunwala, he's muted. I think you ask him to unmute, he'll give his comment.
Sir, I am also requesting you to be present at our webinars and give your valuable input, sir.
I think this team is doing wonderfully well.
Thank you very much, sir.
And I hope that they go on doing the same thing for their whole period.
Thank you very much. But we need your input, sir. So please try to join in whenever you can.
I am joining now today. It's last time also I joined.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, for LRS also I joined. And I'm ready to join for every lecture.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Basu sir, your last comment. Basu sir.
Nothing. It's going on great.
Yeah.
Yeah. But only thing, the faculty is, I am not very happy about that hinge placement and all those. We must do it the correct way because so many people are watching us.
Definitely. So that's why we need your advice, at least to correct them and just to give the your last opinions, which are actually correct.
No, we are being judged by our own cases, no?
No, Vasu, what happens is, if you put cases where there is a straightforward this one, there is not much of discussion to tell. If you show a case where there is something happening like what Ritesh has shown, then there is a lot of discussion and then pros and cons and why and this and that can be discussed about the injuries, regenerate, etc.
Just because of it.
Lot of other teaching points. Number
not
one.
Fault. It is not the question of fault. There are many reasons why some things happen. So how we
teaching points?
Yes, exactly.
There are many teaching points
in such
and
cases.
Why the child was unhappy with the friend?
See, in a master class, when somebody takes a master class, it must cover up everything.
Yeah.
But for case presentations, it's not a master class.
Yeah, that is what Ritesh has to come out with that. With a stiff knee joint, it's a fairly straightforward.
Correct.
But still the child was unhappy with it. So we lost something somewhere. Either the wires are loosened out, so replace it. It happens.
No, it happens.
Whenever we do it also, it happens.
Yes.
Some of the wires has done the job and it has become loose and it hurts the patient. Just one more small revision to change the wires.
Yes, sir. True.
Yeah, because it has done the job of correcting. The full stress has been taken by it. So it has become old, that pins. You get the new pins.
It's very important to make the frame patient friendly and less. That's very, very important, actually.
Thanks, Vasu sir.
Thank you. So I think should we wind up?
Yeah, ma'am, please. Yeah. Conclude, ma'am.
Okay. So I thank everyone. I thank all the faculty members, all the panelists for joining in. It was a great session, great discussion, and good learning points. So thank you very much, everyone, and good night. So we end.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much.